Hello, YouTubers. Alaska Prepper here. Well, we've been waiting for this interview for quite a while. I was hoping to get it to you guys sooner, but some things came up. And anyways, we're going to go ahead and do an interview now with one of our subscribers who's been working in the water treatment field for a while. And I'm going to introduce him here in a minute. But this is in context to the video that I did here probably about 2-3 weeks ago, talking about how there's supposedly over 100 million water users in the U.S. that are not getting the quality of the water that they're being told they're getting. And you probably already know who our subscriber is. His name is Keith B. So you probably see him on our comments all the time because he's always on there commenting. So, Keith, how you doing today, my friend?
Doing great. How are you?
Pretty good, pretty good. Very excited to have you on. I've really, really been wanting to do this interview for a while because I want to get our subscribers and our viewers informed on how to properly detect whether they have good or bad drinking water and how to protect themselves against bad drinking water. So you seem to be the perfect person to have on here. I'm really excited to have you on, and I'm really glad that you're part of our community because now we'll be able to reach one and teach one, as I like to say.
I appreciate you having me, and I will profess not to know everything, and if you ask me something I don't know, I'll let you know and try to find out for you.
All right. Well, that leads me to my disclaimer. So, disclaimer, ladies and gentlemen, I am not an expert in water treatment, and I am not going to say that Keith is an expert as well, even though he works in the industry, because what we're doing here is pure opinion, okay? Everything that is going to be said here is opinionated conversation. And you really do need to do the research yourself. Think about it. We're talking about die, all right? Without good water, you're not going to be healthy. So no matter what you hear here in this interview, make sure you do your own research. Make sure you do your own due diligence. And then please take whatever steps you think are appropriate for you to take to make sure that you're getting good drinking water and to make sure that the water you're drinking is safe as far as keeping you healthy and keeping you alive. Having said that, like I said, we're interviewing Keith today. So I want to welcome Keith and give you a minute or so, Keith, to introduce yourself. Let us know how long you've been doing this. You don't have to say where you're from or anything like that if you don't want to, but take a minute to introduce yourself, please.
All right, my name is Keith, and I work in the water treatment industry, and I work for a city municipality in the southeast United States. I've only been doing this about 3 years, and it's my second career, and I think I've really found a home with this. I was self-employed for about 20 years before moving into this. Our county, our city, actually has two water processing facilities. One of them is surface water, which takes water from a river and distributes it, cleans it, and distributes it. The one I'm currently working at is a groundwater facility, and basically we're drawing out of a deep well. We also have a spring that we can draw from if we need to. And this facility that I'm currently at, we're doing anywhere from 3 to 5 million gallons a day, and really we're averaging about 4.5 to 5 million gallons a day right now. I'm a class two licensed operator. In September, I'll be qualified in September to test for class one, which will be the highest classification, and I expect to get that in September.
Nice, very nice. Keith, do you mind if I ask you what you did prior to this?
I was a photographer, actually. I had a portrait photographer. I had a studio for almost 20 years, and anywhere from 2 to 3.5 full-time employees, depending on the season. And I specialize in families, children, high school seniors, and I really, really thought I'd never see the day that I didn't just love it, and I saw that day and decided it was time to do something else.
Wow, that's very nice. Well, that's good. That's good that you have a second career now, and it seems that you really enjoy doing what you do now, and I think that's what really counts.
I do indeed enjoy it. I was, after being self-employed so long, I was really afraid that I'd never be able to work for anybody again, and this job suits me great.
That's great. That's great. So let's go ahead and get started with the issue at hand here, Keith. And I'm sorry, ladies and gentlemen, but I don't have the article pulled up, the one that we're referencing to here in this question that I'm going to have, but I will leave a link to it if any of you want to take a look back. Now, from what I remember about that article, Keith, it was the one that stated that throughout the United States, there were over 100 million people that were drinking water that the government said was suitable, but that then they came back and said that the amounts of heavy metals and particulates in the water were 7 to 10 times higher than what they deemed safe, and they didn't want to tell the people about it because it would be a PR nightmare. Now, I'm pretty sure you read that article because you had a very good comment and response on it. And was there any validity to that article as far as you can see?
Well, I wouldn't discount the article in whole, but I will tell you that with all the public drinking systems, the EPA is the primacy, and they have very strict guidelines on what we can do and what we can't do. And, you know, whether someone agrees with those particular guidelines, such as, you know, chlorine or fluoride or whatever, that's a whole another topic. But the testing that we have to do every day, for instance, we do every. I work 12-hour shifts, and every shift there are over 200 tests or checks that are done every day.
Wow!
And you know, so, and then some things that we do only monthly, and that are beyond the capability of the lab we have on grounds here. That you know, we'll send out to the state lab to have them test, and that's you know, it's just required by in order to keep operating. And if we fall outside the guidelines, there are certain things that would come out in the yearly public water report that every water supplier has to send out to their customers once a year. And ours, for instance, are sent out with your water bill, the full report. They don't just send a link where you can go look at it if you like. But there are certain things that are very minor that might just show up in that report. Other things that are taken very seriously, where it's a public notice and it's all over the news stations trying to publicly notify, you know, everybody to take precautions or boil water or whatever until we get it straightened out. And I'm glad to say that we've never had that at our municipality. So, a long answer, I know, but I wouldn't discount the entire article, but I certainly have opinions on part of the angle that it took and the references that they referenced.
Okay, so I'm going to get a little bit off course here real quick, and I know that everyone's probably already heard this before about, what is it, Flint, Michigan, about how they had bad water there. I think they had lead in it, and their state government knew about it for a while, and they still let the people keep on drinking that stuff. So I'm not going to go. It's like saying if one cop is bad, all cops are bad. And that's not the truth. Right. You know, that's not the truth. You know, this may happen. You know, this may be a localized problem here and there. And there may be some corruption here and there. But you can't say that the entire system as a whole is corrupt just because there's one very small part of it that is. But what I'm getting to add here is do you recommend that people have a water filtration system at home, whether or not their municipality says that their water is good? Because in fact, what you're getting from your municipality is a piece of paper saying, hey, this is good. Would you recommend that even if you're getting that piece of paper saying that it's good, would you recommend that they have an additional layer of protection in a water, you know, a water purification system at home?
Okay, let me before I address that specific question, I'll address the Flint, Michigan thing. If I'm not mistaken, the some corrupt city people knew of that issue,
right?
And the root cause was that the city made an economic choice to switch water supplies because it was cheaper to get it from another supply, and then the supply was bad, and they covered it. I'm not so sure the state was aware and tried to cover it up, but maybe I'm wrong on that. I could be completely wrong. But to answer your question about if people should have water filtration systems, home water filtration systems are so cheap, if you will get peace of mind out of having it, there's no reason not to. That being said, and I can just speak from my municipality. There are certain things that my bosses may do around here to save a little bit of money, but, you know, they might save some money on a light bill. They might save some money on fuel cost or whatever. But the rule around here is that if I think that I can adjust a dosage of chlorine or alum or whatever, and it would still be okay, that is absolutely off guards. We're not saving money that has anything to do with the quality of water.
Okay.
So and I tell people too, as far as, you know, it only applies to me, but the water that I produce goes to my mother's house.
Right.
And that's all anybody can know about the quality of it. So
that's right.
Anyway, so I personally have some water filtration systems as backup in case of catastrophe. And I'll tell you later on. I think you may give me an opportunity to tell you what,
yes,
I have or whatever.
Absolutely. Okay.
But honestly, they're so cheap. If you'll get peace of mind out of it, it just won't hurt a thing.
Okay. Great. Okay. So let me go on to the next question. This was a question that one of our subscribers put on the comments, and the question is: what are nitrates, and how can we be sure that we are not ingesting them from our drinking water / cooking water?
Okay, nitrates in water generally come from fertilizers. From people water or fertilizing their lawns, or more oftentimes from commercial farming operations. And in a rain situation, for instance, our plant that uses its source as a river as its source, we may have a little bit of nitrates in there after a heavy rain, but not really, hardly detectable. So to remove them, you're probably going to go with one of those three-stage filter, a reverse osmosis filter.
Oh, okay.
And I think that those will remove. Now, one thing that perhaps the technology on those filters have changed since I had one. I used to run a reverse osmosis and deionization system years ago when I had freshwater or saltwater aquariums. And there was a lot of waste for those systems. For every gallon of water that I got, it seems like, I can't remember exactly now, but a lot of water went down the drain for me to get that gallon of water. So it wasn't a very efficient system, and perhaps the technology now.
Well, are you talking about the reverse osmosis system?
Right, and deionization is what I had. So
okay.
I don't know where the waste came in. So
yeah, I am. I have a reverse osmosis system here, and you're right. You're probably giving up about a gallon of water for every gallon of water that it makes.
Okay.
I would just say that's just a guesstimate. You know, I'm just estimating that, because I know that every time that I empty my system, I'll hear a trickle going into my sink drain, which is where the outlet is connected to from the RO system. I'll hear a trickle for quite a while. So I'm guessing that that's all that back flush that is flushing out. So
that sounds about right.
So, okay. And then another question is, what are coliforms, and why should we be concerned about having them in our water?
Coliforms are bacteria that live just about, I can't say across the board, they live in every warm-blooded mammal, but in the intestines of almost all warm-blooded mammals, animals, including humans. So where coliforms come into drinking water is that, say that there's a chicken house or a large cattle operation near a well source, or even if you've just got a lot of deer in your area, or in your case, maybe I think you have moose up there.
Right.
But there's a chance, generally, that stuff gets filtered out by the ground as the water is seeping through the ground into the aquifer. But sometimes it doesn't. And so we test every day for coliforms in our test sites around the county. We test people's wells for them.
Oh,
and,
nice.
And what we almost always see on wells is there is a presence of total coliforms, which means that there are bacteria there that could be harmful. To test for every one of them is just almost impossible, but once we see total coliforms, we will then go ahead and do a fecal coliform test, and sometimes we see that, sometimes we don't, but the fecal coliform can be very dangerous. So especially if you're already in poor health, or if you're for young people or whatever.
Okay, so is that is coliform something that can be treated with chlorine or with boiling?
Absolutely, boiling or chlorine will do it. And it just doesn't take very much chlorine at all. And what you want is unscented chlorine bleach from even just from the dollar store, the cheapest stuff you can get. And my tests aren't conclusive yet, but I tested a friend of mine's well a few weeks ago, and it showed up for fecal coliform. So we're going to do a retest with different doses of chlorine to see exactly how low of a dose will actually cure his problem.
Okay, nice. Very good.
Go ahead. Can I go ahead and say something about chlorine?
Yes, absolutely.
I know a lot of people are afraid of chlorine, and they don't want it to have anything to do with it in their water. But if that is you, chlorine dissipates. So if you sanitize your water with chlorine, you can set it out on the counter for a day, or set, especially in the sun, it'll burn off really fast. So it will sterilize the water, and then just the setting it in an open container will dissipate it. And then there's no chlorine in it at all after your water's been sanitized. So, nice. So the chlorine doesn't necessarily stay when you put it in.
That's great, Keith, because you just answered the next question I was going to ask you.
Okay.
So you're ahead of me. So having said all that, is there for people that want to be extra safe? Like for example, myself, I am not that I'm untrustworthy of the water that I get. I get it from a local source or from a public source. But even getting the water from a public source, and I know that a lot of people here, just a quick stat, here in Fairbanks, about 70% of the people in Fairbanks live in what are called not wet homes, but dry homes, which means that you have to haul your own water. So about 70% of the families here, they have to actually haul their own water to their home and put it in a reserve tank or a cistern. So I know that the water that I get is good, because if it wasn't, there'd be a lot of people that were sick. But even with that, go ahead, Keith.
Now, the people in your area have dry homes because it's impractical to drill wells, or they're just not water aquifers to source, or?
Well, no, there's plenty of water aquifers. It's just drilling a well in this area is extremely expensive.
Okay.
So it's a lot more cost. Yeah, it's a lot more cost effective to actually get water. So I mean, I'm not sure if expensive for me would be expensive for someone else, but to drill a well here where I live, I'm looking at about $50,000 to drill a well.
Okay.
Yeah, and that's almost twice as much as what I paid for my land.
Wow.
So to get water. Me hauling my own water, I probably spend up. And of course, you know that when you haul your own water, you're a lot more frugal with it at the house. You're not taking 30-minute showers. You know, you shower and you get out. So, but here, we probably go through about, I want to say, 350 gallons a week is all we go through as a family of four. So, and that costs me about... About $40 a month is what it cost me to get water to run our household. So it's not too bad hauling it yourself.
Yeah, that'd take a long time to hit 50 grand at $40 a month.
Yeah, it would take a long time, return on investment for that one.
Yeah.
So, hey, Keith, is there, so if you had to make a list or make some recommendations on what people could do to test their water, so if they didn't want to go through the expense of getting a professional person to go out there and test it, and they wanted to do it themselves, are there some things that we can do? Are there some products that we can purchase ourselves, that we can actually test the water and feel comfortable that the water that's coming out of our tap is actually good?
I'm not aware of any, and perhaps there are. I don't know, but I'll tell you, almost every municipality will offer some sort of testing, I believe. At least in my area of the country, I'm not familiar with any that will offer that for you. What we test for every day, of course, we test our, to make sure our chlorine dosage is right, our fluoride dosage is right. We test for coliforms. We test for iron and magnesium, or manganese. I have a hard time remembering to say that word right. And we test the turbidity constantly, and that is basically the cloudiness of the water. And at the groundwater plant I'm working at right now, we honestly, the water we take in is cleaner than a lot of systems, the water they send out. So we're blessed there. So for home testing, I'm not sure. But I think the testing that we offer, I think there's a $30 charge. And if you're testing a well, once a year should be fine, unless you have a big event where you think your aquifer is. And
okay.
You might want to test after that. So I'm not sure. I may be wrong on that. It's just not on my radar to know about.
Now, let me ask you this, and don't beat me up on this, because, I'm just a rookie when it comes to water treatment.
Right.
So I have one of those PPM pens that you stick in water and it'll give you a number. And supposedly the lower the number is, the better quality water you have. Is that valid? Is that a valid testing equipment? Do you know what I'm talking about? It's like a little pen that tells you how many parts per million of whatever particles there may be in that water.
Well, I had one of those when I had the saltwater aquariums as well, and I used it and relied on it. But the thing is, you're correct in saying that you're measuring parts per million, but
of what?
Parts per million of what?
Exactly, so, of what? Okay, and that's what I figured you'd tell me, is because it tells me parts per million, but it doesn't tell you this is what the parts per million mean. This is what's in there. So okay.
If I remember, the pen that I had that I used was parts per million of total dissolved solids.
That's what it is.
Which would basically be the waste for the fish that we had.
Okay.
Or that I had. And I relied on it. I had a clean system, so I never really had any problems with it. But it would not be an indicator of total water quality. You could have a very low parts per million of total dissolved solids, but you could still have fecal coliform in there and just not even know it until you wake up at 4 a.m. puking your guts out.
Okay, well, that makes a lot of sense. Well, I mean, I am when I got that little pen, I tested it on my water before I put it through my RO system, and then I tested it afterwards, and the counts before was 170. Which, from what I understand, 170 is okay to drink, at least as far as the instructions on the box that I got with that. And then after I put it through the RO system, I was amazed to see that it was like 6 or something like that. So it went from 170 ppms to like 0.6 ppms.
So even if 170 is safe, 6 is better, right?
Absolutely, but it's like you said, though. It's like you said, though, if it depends on what that 6 is.
Right.
So, but okay, I'm glad you answered that question, because I actually rely on that little thing a lot. I use it to test my RO system to let me know when I need to change the filters out. And it's good enough for that. It's at least good enough to tell me, hey, your RO system is starting to work, less efficiently than it was before, and I can change my filters out. But that's a good point that you made, that it's not the PPM necessarily, but what they actually are, and that's the important part. Okay.
Yep.
Well, last question, Keith. If I was your relative or someone that you really cared about, and I thought that there was something wrong with my water, and I asked you if there is a system to clean water, what kind of advice would you give your own relatives? If they were concerned that their water, obviously you can go and test your relative's water, but if I didn't have the ability of testing my water, if I didn't have the ability of going to a municipality and asking them to test it, Is there something that you would recommend? Is there something that you use or have used that you would feel comfortable with saying, hey, I used this and it really did a good job for me. And if I were to tell someone to use it, this is what I would tell them.
Certainly. I'll tell you what I do, and I won't say that it's the best. It's just what I settled on. And again, I personally completely trust the water system that we have because I see it every day. And like I said, it goes to my mother's house, and it goes to my house as well. But more importantly, it goes to mother's. But I have some filtrations as backups in case of catastrophe or in case there's a power outage. And we do have power outages at our plant. But we, you know, with the tanks around the county and we've got at least several hours reserved. But I made a homemade Berkey system. And I'll tell you, if anybody on YouTube wants to go look it up, I follow a guy named Boss of the Swamp.
Oh, Boss of the Swamp. I follow him too.
Yeah. He's very practical and easy to watch. And he made a homemade Berkey system. So I ended up buying two stainless steel pots at a flea market for $16. I got the filters for $100. So as best I can remember, I have and I bought a spigot too. So I think I have like $123 in this whole system. I have tested it through our lab, actually drawing water out of my very dirty ditch next to the road, and
nice.
Running it through there.
Awesome.
And it brought it up at least to the standards of well water. So at the end of the day, I did still have total coliforms in there, but I didn't have fecal in there that had been in there before it was filtered. So, you know, it was clear to look at it. It's safe to drink. And actually, it was safe to drink because it didn't have the fecal coliforms in.
Oh,
so
good.
I'd recommend that. And the thing about their demonstrations about even removing food dye from the thing, that's don't pay any attention to that, but they are really good filters. So
okay.
Also, since we're talking about Boss of the Swamp, and yours is a prepper channel, everybody else may like to know that Boss of the Swamp also has the most straightforward, simple outdoor shower there is, and go check that out.
Yep,
so,
I've seen that too. He uses that inside also.
Yeah, he does.
I think he heats it outside, and then he brings it inside.
That's correct.
Did you see that episode where he heated it with the sun?
Yep, I've done that, and it works like a charm. So
nice. Just to put my two cents in there also, you can also use those, because I have Berkey water filter also. That's like my backup as well. I use my reverse osmosis system as an everyday thing. But I also have a backup Berkey just in case the power goes out and I don't have a pump pumping anything into my RO. But you can also use a couple of food grade 5-gallon buckets as well. And the only extra step you would have to do is just drill a couple of holes in there and then use one bucket as the catchment system and the other bucket as the actual filtration system. So
that would be cheaper than what I did, and you'd have an extra gallon of capacity over.
Yeah, there you go. You have an extra gallon. So
the other thing I've done, and I'm not saying that this is the best, it's just that I saw a YouTube guy, and I thought, hey, and it's an engineer guy that knows this stuff, and I thought, I'm going to do that. There was a channel called AVE, three letters, AVE, and he does a lot of tool reviews, and he's, you know, an engineer guy. Sometimes, you know, if you have sensitive ears, you might not want to listen to him. But he had this video while I think his wife was paddling the canoe, and he was filtering water up front out of the lake that they were in and drinking it. And I got the research in this filter. It's an MSR MiniWorks, letter M, letter S, letter R, and I think the filter is a MiniWorks. It screws on the top of an Nalgene bottle. And I think you can fill that bottle up in about 20 seconds, 30 seconds maybe.
Okay.
So I have one of those in my car at all times in case I get somewhere stranded and need to filter water. And I also have one at the house that used to be in my other vehicle. So I actually have two of those.
That's not a mini Sawyer, is it?
No, it's not a straw at all. It's actually a handheld pump. It's a small package. It travels easily. And you, like I say, you just screw it right on top to an Allergene bottle, and you don't even have to do that. You could just filter into a glass or something, right, if you wanted
to. Because I have some mini Sawyer water filters, and they're like very highly recommended. All of the reviews that I've read about them are very good, and they are probably one of the least expensive water filters I've ever bought. They're like $21, $22. And it says that they're ceramic, and it says that they're good for 100,000 gallons.
And now, are those straws you're talking about?
You can hook up a straw to it, but it's not a straw filter, but you can hook up a straw to it. I'm going to do a review of one of those here, hopefully soon. The weather's nice outside, so I'm going to do a review because one of our subscribers asked if I would do a review on the Sawyer Mini Filter. And there's a lot of ways you can use it. You can hook it up to a 5-gallon bucket with water and have it filtered through there. There's two or three ways that you can actually use it. You can use it as a straw, or you can use it and hook it up to your Camelback if you have a Camelback as well. Okay. So I think I'll probably do a review on one of those just to test it out. I've got a few, and I've always heard good things about it, but the truth of the matter is that I've never had to use them, and I have not. I know that preppers should use their things, but the truth is that I have not used one yet, so I'm going to do a review on one of those.
I'll be very interested to see that, because I've never used one, but when I see those straw products, I'm thinking you're going to have to exert a whole lot of energy to get a little bit of water through that thing if you're trying to suck it through.
Absolutely.
I'm really curious about that.
So I think I'll do a little work on that and see if I can do a video on that here in the next week or two. So Keith, I think that's all we've got for now, my friend. I want to say thank you very much, man. I really appreciate you doing this. I am sure that our community is going to get a lot out of this interview. And hopefully you'll check the interview out as well and answer questions, because I know there's going to be more questions coming up. So I'm hoping that you'll get on there and start answering some questions as they come in.
Certainly. When it's posted, I'll keep an eye on it. And if anybody asks anything that I can answer, I will. Awesome. And if I can't answer it, I'll be honest about it.
That's great. Well, I want to thank you again, my friend. I truly do appreciate you coming on. If you wouldn't mind sticking around for about a minute or so, I'm going to go ahead and sign out. And then we'll talk for a couple of minutes before I let you go.
Great.
All right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I hope you enjoyed the interview. I hope that you got a lot out of it. You heard Keith. He said that he'll be looking out for any questions. So if you do have any additional questions that were not covered during this short time that we had, please feel free to ask. And if you enjoy the content, please go ahead and give us a thumbs up. And if you have someone that you care about, make sure you share. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, having said that, remember to be good to each other. When good people do good things happen. Remember to reach one, teach one, and repeat. If we all did this, the world would be a better place. And you know that it will be a better place. Many blessings to all of you and your families. This is Alaska Prepper, and I'm out.